my face, trying to incite us to fight and all this. And then, you know, we just knew when you look at their personnel, no disrespect, because Hank Gathers was a great player, obviously, but, you know, he had since passed. Bo Kemble was a very good player. But other than that, they just physically couldn't match up. And they basically were going to try to beat us at our style. And so for us, it was, like you said, it was a tailor-made game for us.
They couldn't press us. In 100 years, they couldn't press us. And I knew that there was no way we could have lost that game. And it was the only, I was so confident. My wife got mad at me.
Our team was really confident before that game. I remember what Greg told the media. He said, we respect LMU. It's a great story. They're living a dream, but the dream's about to end.
When we rode on a bus, we drove right by the Loyola Hotel. And I don't allow any talking on the bus. We're always quiet. I want to concentrate. When we drove by their hotel, Greg shouts out, we're going to wake them up tonight. We're going to wake them up today. I'll never forget that. We sure did.
It was a lot of tension between both teams. To me, both teams was filled with inner city guys, inner city youngsters, and we all both had to, both teams, especially when Hank was there. And we played them in the guard. I mean, we played them in Thomas and Mack at the beginning of the year. It was just a heated rivalry game, a lot of trash talking, and we was going at it. And what happened was, this guy says that Hank and a couple other guys cussed me out or said something to me.
He threw your stuff in the second row.
Yeah.
First play of the game. See, man, this ain't junior college. Get that shit out of here.
Oh! Give me like that. And this is what I told this dude and this dude. Yeah. This is what I told this dude. They gave me, they didn't play. Dave Butler, Moses Carey did not play.
Right. They were out
and this game here, when they played, there was no way they were about to win that game.
Yeah, we should point out, it was an interesting season and a challenging one for Tuck to coach, because Dave Rice and Larry Johnson were the only two players that year, for all kinds of reasons, to be available for every single game. So that was one other thing that certainly was a challenge for you, not knowing, and sometimes right before the game, not knowing who
always
you had.
Always right before the game. I remember we played in Philadelphia. We were playing Temple in Philadelphia the night before the game. I'm sitting in the bar with the guys who refereed the LaSalle and one of the other Philadelphia teams. I'm sitting with officials, and I get a phone call. It's like 10:30 at night. The NC2A said Anderson Hunt can't play. Anderson couldn't play because he was behind on a student on a loan. He had a loan, and he missed the payment on the loan. So they said he had to sit out. First time I'd ever heard of that rule. I don't think they ever. I was stunned, and I was so upset. I never said a word to the team till we went to the game, and as the guys got dressed, I told them. I said, fellas, we can go one of two ways. We can let the NC2A ruin our season, or else we can get madder in hell and kick the crap out of everybody. And that's what we tried to do. We just got, every time they would do something like that, our guys would respond, and we would come out and play better, and we played tougher, and it was such a great group to be around. I just loved being around them.
Beat Loyola Marymount. Now you move on to Georgia Tech. You're in the Final Four. Georgia Tech has Lethal Weapon 3, is what they were calling them. Dennis Scott, Kenny Anderson, Brian Oliver, these were the guys that were supposed to be the ones who would have the best chance at this point in time to knock off the Runnin' Rebels. It didn't happen. Georgia Tech, it was a good game. They came out and they had you early. But let's show you some stuff from the Georgia Tech game. Again, starting the second half. Greg, you had it going, but you guys had to catch up a little bit. What happened in the first half of that game where you guys were down, do you think?
Dennis Scott hit some shots from downtown. I mean, he was hitting shots. I thought he was out of the gym when they were going in.
Yeah, part of it was, too, though. We didn't really compete. I never forget at halftime when we came in. I don't think coach has ever been more upset. Oh, at halftime, he went off. And I think in part two, I think deep down we kind of had a lot. We probably had too much respect for him. Like, because I don't think we really competed the way. And that's what his message was. He was, I had never seen him that upset about how little we competed in the first half. And I think we might have started believing a lot of the stuff that people were saying. Because they were, you know, Dennis Scott is probably as good a shooter as ever played college basketball. And Kenny Anderson may have been the best freshman point guard to have ever played college basketball. I was glad when that game was over.
I didn't see any team that was real guard heavy and depending on their guard. I didn't see them beating us because of these two dudes and Stacey Ogman. I never seen that. These guys, they like you said, Kenny and Dennis was great players and a great shooter, but I didn't see the heart and what these dudes was doing, the way these guys sat down. That whole tournament was won by these guards and Stacy and the defensive end.
To me, one of the highlights of that tournament was Duke had beaten Arkansas the first night. Duke had beaten Arkansas. We had to play Georgia Tech. And all the ACC fans, half the arena was ACC fans. Yeah. They were chanting ACC before our game. And then we beat Georgia Tech. And when we were walking off the floor, the UNLV fans were chanting Big West. Big West. I thought, boy, is this something. Half the arena is yelling ACC. We have our UNLV fans yelling Big West. That was really, I never forgot that. He comes in my office one day and he says, Coach, he says, if you start me, I'll lead the nation in rebounding. I'll lead the nation in rebounding. And you know, he might have.
He would have, Coach, you know he would.
They run him into an Ogman screen, but he comes back, knocked to the Spurs' hands, an opportunity basket for the running Rebs.
Well, it really wouldn't be complete if we didn't welcome in Moses Scurry, the loudest player in all of college basketball. Nobody screamed like Moses when he got a rebound. Nobody. David was pretty close, but Moses was unbelievable. Welcome in.
Thank you.
Now, through the Georgia Tech game, here's one of the plays that one of the other key players, Stacy Ogman, made. That when you watch this, this is a great block. It was called a goaltend, but this is one of those great plays that you see defensively from the Jerry Tarkanian coach teams. Watch him come out of nowhere. And that was called a goaltend.
That was a bad call, too.
That was a bad call, but you got to look at Stacy. Stacy was around 6'6", 6'7", and he had these incredible long arms. So just as a block shot, sometimes it looked like a goaltender because he had these long arms and this long body. But as far as defense, Stacy was one of the best.
But yeah, he sat down Sean Elliott. He was tripping him, and they tripped him over his foot one time. I'm like, whoa, Stacy, you're not playing.
Every game that we went out and they had a top score, Coach Tarkanian would put Stacy on the best score, and he would shut everybody down.
Talk about the enforcers. We got Moses here, David here.
Except Cedric Ceballos.
Yeah. That's the only guy. David Moses, both involved in a key play here. Right at the end of the Georgia Tech game, let's check out how that turned out and get Moses' take on this one here right at the very end.
It wasn't a real power forward move, was it? Was it a real power forward move? Get a rebound, Mo.
There's a rebound.
Yeah, it is.
Mo gets them all.
Look at this guard he give it to.
Well, that was a nice play right there. Moses gave me an outlet. And like I was saying earlier, everybody had a role. Yeah. And we had big guys that can really handle the ball, but we know how far to take it. Two or three dribbles and give it up.
But even if you go back to the other thing that made that play is that Moses helped defense. On the penetration by Kenny Anderson. He came out, he showed really hard. I mean, you think about it, a guy that had a handle like Kenny Anderson, Moses made him give up his dribble.
Yeah.
That was a huge part of that play because he gives it up. It allows us to rotate back into position and come up with that rebound, which led to that opportunity.
I mean, it was your attitude out there, that's my ball. No one else is going to take my ball.
Oh, very much so.
Just give me that thing.
Yeah, I had to have it.
I had to have it.